the good days outweigh the bad days. How many of us has God dried all of our tears away? Turn our midnight into day. What do we want to say? Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Somebody say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For all you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. For making a way for me. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain. Thank God for this day. This is another day that the Lord has allowed us to see. Another day that he has blessed us to come into his presence, gather in his name, and worship him. There is a word from the Lord today. The gospel according to Luke, 15th chapter. Verses 11 through 20. Luke 15, verses 11 through 20. And as is our custom, won't you hold your Bibles high and repeat after me? This is the word of God.
It has
transformative power.
I will praise God
for this preaching moment. And I declare that after this moment,
that
I shall never,
ever
be the same. God be praised. In Luke 15, 11 through 20. In the New Revised Standard Version, you find these words recorded. Then Jesus said, there was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me. So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had, traveled to a distant country, and there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating. No one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am, dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands. Yeah. So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word, the edification of our hearts and our souls. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. I want to talk today for a few moments from the subject, God's love in restoration. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. God's love in restoration. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being in the midst of us. Lord, we pray that you continually abide with us. Move in us. Transform us by the renewing of our minds. Now, Lord, let the words of my mouth not be of my own understanding nor my opinion. But Lord, let them fall fresh from you. Someone may be saved on this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Let every heart say, amen.
Amen.
God's love in restoration. I don't know if many of you got the spiritual memo, but trials and tribulations are a part of life. It is certain that no matter how you live your life, no matter what resources may come your way, that you will find yourself at some point in life singing, "Trouble in my way, I got to cry sometime. I lay awake at night, but that's all right. Jesus will fix it after a while." These trials and tribulations come, if you will, in two areas of life. One sort of trial and tribulation comes from the natural order of life. As we lean on Scripture in this life, you will have trouble. It rains on the just and the unjust. So there are certain trials of life that will occur just because life is what it is. I declare that you will never find a person that lived this life that did not have some trouble.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So when you see someone that seemingly is standing up on a pedestal, I declare, don't look at their end result. For if they are standing on the pedestal, that means they have gone through some things to be the men or women that God has called them to be. And so there are trials that are part of the natural order of life. And those trials, we may not understand their reason or their rationale. We may not understand why bad things happen to good people. But they are indeed a factor of life. But not only are there trials that come within the natural order of life, but there are trials that are the result of our decision.
Yes,
there's some trouble, if you will, that we bring upon ourselves. There's some decisions that we make that cause us to lay awake at night. There's some things that we bring upon ourselves when we operate against the natural plan of God. And so today I want to talk to you shortly about those trials that we bring on ourselves. Those things that we can control within our very own grasp. Oftentimes I speak with people when they are going through episodes of famine in their lives. You all know episodes of famine. I lost my job. That's an episode of famine. I've got bad relationship with my husband or my wife. An episode of famine. My kid is in jail and he just can't seem to get himself straight. an episode of famine. I feel depressed all the time. I feel angry all the time. Episodes of famine. I feel on the very outskirts of life. Episodes of famine. And so right there in that office or by email or text or phone call, I experience conversations with people that have gone through their trials. And oftentimes in their episodes of famine, as they have seemingly at the world's last drop, as it seems like they are ready to give up, they often mention while they're in the valley of famine, they often say, God's wrath is punishing me. And that's the first thing they resort to. God is angry at me. The Lord is testing me. And I'll stop by here to tell you today that God's wrath is real. But what they are experiencing and what we are experiencing oftentimes in our famine valleys is not the wrath of God, but actually the experience with the devil. Oh, did you catch it? The problem that you're going through is not because you're within the wrath of God. But you have had a one-on-one relationship with the devil. And I know in a few weeks, folks are going to be putting on their Halloween outfits and folks are going to be watching their horror movies. But I want you to know that some of the stuff about demonic possession is real stuff. So I want you to understand today, you might not say amen, you might just say ouch. And if the devil is in you, you might do a little turning and you might do a little twitching. But when you're going through the valleys of life, the valley is not necessarily a God that is so mad at you that he's making your life miserable, but it's indeed the fact that you have turned your life over to the enemy. So you're broke not because God is mad at you. You've turned yourself over to the enemy. You're angry not because God is punishing you, but you're angry because you have turned yourself over to the enemy. God's wrath is real. But what we are not experiencing oftentimes is not God's wrath, but an experience with Lucifer. An experience with Satan. I declare maybe we would live our lives a little bit better if we understood that the Satan is real.
Yes, he is.
That he does not wear a red pajama suit with some horns on his head. That everything that you see on TV and everything that you digest into your ears that is not of the word of God, be careful. Because it is the very nature of Satan trying to get you. In this morning's text, we find that there are several factors at play in the life of the prodigal son. Several decisions that are made that can lead us to a miserable life based on our very own decisions. First thing, that factor that can bring about a trial of our own is the spirit of self-absorption. The spirit of me, myself, and I. The spirit of I'm going to do it no matter what anybody says. The spirit of I'm going to press no matter who's hurt by my actions. And so we've got to be careful of decisions that are predicated on me, myself, and I. Look at the prodigal son. The first thing that he was concerned with was what was his. He went to his father and said, Daddy, what is going to belong to me when you close your eyes? I don't have time to wait on that. I don't care if it makes you broke. I don't care if it makes mama broke. I don't care if it takes away from my brother. consider others beyond yourself in decisions that you make. You got to consider others beyond yourself that they may see God. But the spirit of self-absorption is the first one. Spirit, when you sow in to yourself that you think you matter to people so much that they can't keep on pressing without you. Some folk don't come to church because they worried about somebody that may be offended by them. When you give yourself that much power to think that you're that important to someone else, you're on your way to the arms of the enemy. Look at your neighbor and say, you ain't that important. Thinking somebody didn't come to church because of you? You ain't that important. Somebody didn't come to church because the devil got in, and there's nothing you can do about it. And so you just need to press your way. Self-absorbed, self-centeredness. That is the way in which that causes us to make bad decisions. Think about the bad decisions you made. I think about mine. They're about Andrew Hunt and Andrew Hunt and Julie. It have nothing to do with nobody else. Self-absorption. The first thing we see is he was self-absorbed. He had a me, myself, and I mentality. That's the road to a bad decision. Next thing that he did is he was comfortable being separate from the Father. He was not put out by his Father, but he elected to leave his Father. In other words, he had decided that the plan that his Father had for him was not good enough. He had decided that the pace that his Father was working on to give him riches was too slow. He was no longer patient. And the devil operates in our impatience. He operates when he designs our me, myself, and I mentality to cause us to be separated from him. Separated from him. So he got his second decision. It was me, myself, and I. And he no longer wanted to operate within the plan of his Father. No longer could wait. How many decisions have we made because we just wasn't going to be patient? Threw our hands in the air. Enough is enough. I'm not going to be bothered with these black people. I know y'all didn't say black people. With these African Americans. It's time that I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. That is a spirit that operates out of a desire to not be patient. But I declare today that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles, run and not get weary, walk and not faint. We push ourselves away.
Thank you, Lord.
Make bad decisions. Me, myself, and I.
Ouch.
We can't wait on the plan of the Father, and we find ourselves being separated from the Father.
Yes.
The third thing is, we don't recognize when we're in the devil's hands. Because we operate, I guess, with emotions and not pure spirituality. Oh, you might not catch it today. I told you, you might not say it again today. But I hope you're a little bit better today.
Oh, that's all right. Come on. Thank you.
See, I had someone come into my office, and I get to see y'all on Facebook and just be who you are on Facebook. Even though some of y'all crazy, I ain't judging that. Just stay on that. Just stay on that. That's not my purpose. It's good because I get to just keep up with how y'all doing. Y'all know if you have a birthday, if I see it, I'll text you. If I see you in the hospital, don't feel bad about being on Facebook. But I watch a member of our church living high off the hog on Facebook. Now, none of y'all can really know who it is, because all of y'all, a lot of y'all live high off the hog. I know you're gonna unfriend me tomorrow, but that's all right. I ain't mad at you.
That's all right.
Watch this. Living good. Living good. Went through some trials and tribulations as we all do. Came back to the church and we rejoice. An individual that come back to the church, but when they spoke to me, they leaned on, oh, God is punishing me and bringing me back. I said, no. See, what you missed is that when you was living good, that's when the devil was right by your side. See, when you was flashing that Cavassier on Facebook, that the devil was right by your side. If you can't say amen, say out. It's tight, but it's right. When you was going out taking pictures of your states, and how a good time and not coming into the house of the Lord, then the problem was you had given yourself over to the enemy. And that's what the enemy does. He works on our emotions. That's why we got to be careful about this new spirituality that materializes God. Because the enemy operates in materialism. And just because things are going good don't mean that that's the Lord helping things go good with you. That, and especially when you have decided to separate.
Come on.
When you have decided to separate from God. And you find that things are going so good, things are going so right. You done met the love of your life. You done graduated from school, but you ain't going to church. Let me tell you, that is not God operating. That is the enemy keeping you away from God, distracting you by all types of materialism. How does he work? I'm gonna keep it PG. He works in the presence of euphoria. I feel so good. I feel so good, this must be right. If loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. Euphoria. And you think that you're in some kind of special situation. Your emotions, your feelings, your heightened senses. You're feeling good about yourself. You got a pep in your step, a glide in your stride. But understand this, that is when the enemy, when you are not in God's presence, that is when the enemy is working to kill, steal, and destroy you. Well, that's what it is. Can you see the prodigal son? I'm large and in charge. Popping bottles all around town. Like Lil Wayne, making it rain all around town. He got his friends all around town. He's eating in the best places all around town. He must be somebody. In the midst of his materiality, he had given himself over to the enemy. Good. Living good.
Yes.
Being happy. Measure what real happiness is. If your real happiness is measured into that person that you're with, they're just material. They won't last all the way. If your real happiness is rest in the fact that you simply getting a check every 2 weeks, let me tell you, your job can be here today and gone tomorrow. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? When it seems like you got everything straight, that's what frustrates me about God's people. God help you graduate and don't go to come to church no more. As soon as you get two nickels and a nice little car, when he's on the bus, you come to church every week. But as soon as you get two nickels, can't make it to church no more. Had some shout before you met him. Lifted your hands in praise before you met him. Now you go to dinner with a few steak dinners on Saturday night and can't get up on Sunday morning. I don't understand it. And so we got to understand that the enemy operates in this stuff that makes us feel good, will distract our attention. But this is what happens. If you watch the decisions that you make, you're riding high. See, that's what the enemy does. He wants to trick you. So if he tricks you, he gives you everything you want. Gave you that man that you wanted. Gave you that woman that you want. Gave you that job that you want. Gave you that ride that you want. Oh, you some big time person now. Clothes that you want. House that you want. Makes you think that you're doing something where you don't need the Father. Oh, I hope y'all watching this. You don't need your daddy anymore because you got what you want. It was about me, myself, and I. But look what he does. He puts you up there and he lets you fall. Because the next thing after you live good, you find yourself in famine. Famine, what did the prodigal son find himself in? He was hungry. He was so hungry that he hired himself out. And what that means, he got a job, y'all. He didn't need a job when he was with his father, but he got a job. He got a job. He got a job feeding the swine. He was so hungry that he wanted to be there himself and eat out of the trough of the swine. And so, when we're in the hands of the enemy, he takes us up high.
Yes, he does.
And we find ourselves in the valley.
Come on, Pastor. Come on, T.
We find ourselves in the valley.
Yes.
Not because God put you in the valley.
Right.
Look at your neighbor and say, I'm in the valley because of me. We find ourselves at our lowest point. Sometimes this is one type of trial. We find ourselves in our lowest point because we miss the fact that Satan is aggressively pursuing us. He aggressively pursues us to give us something, to steal it, to kill us, and destroy us. And so when you find yourself in the valley of life, when you find yourself because of your own decisions, out of work, out of money, of time, understand that that is not God punishing you. That is the enemy doing what he is desired to do to you. He desired to break your back. He desired to have you live in famine. He is on the verge of achieving his goal. To separate us from God. That's why Paul is so insistent about, I will let nothing separate me from the love of God. Because the enemy designs to separate us, to destroy us. Anybody ever felt like they were going to lose their mind? That wasn't God making you lose your mind. That's demonic forces. That's principalities and powers. Evil spirits in high places. And I know you may not want to believe in this stuff, but it's real.
Yes, it's real, Pastor.
So look at what the prodigal son did. He was a me, myself, and I kind of guy. He was comfortable and separated himself from the Father. He mistook living good, from being in the joyful presence of his Father. And he brought famine upon himself. It was all him. Nobody else. But in the final episode, that's what gives us our hope today.
Yes.
In the final episode of this oh so familiar passage, we see the prodigal son taking control of his situation. And I want you, my father's children, in the midst of your trials. We all make mistakes. Take control of your situation. The prodigal son knew that he had let his father down. He knew he did not belong in the position that he found himself in. He knew that it was not his father's intention. And he knew that if he just had stayed with the father, he would have been all right. My favorite passage of this text says that the prodigal son came to himself. So in the midst of your storm, sometimes all you got to do is come to yourself. The only thing you got to do is be accountable that God will fix your situation. Be accountable that there's still room at your father's table. It is not God's wrath that was upon him. He came to himself. Watch this. God allowed the trials. But God didn't cause the trials. When we assess our journey today, I want you to ask yourself a question whatever you're going through. Is it God allowing the trial or causing the trial? Is it upon the natural order? Or is it a part of what we're talking about today? The decisions we have made ourselves. It's time out to stop blaming God for our issues. It's time out. Stop being mad at God for what we have or what we don't have. But it's time for us to understand that God allows us to go through sometimes simply because he wants to get our attention. He wants us to redirect our attention to him. He wants us to no longer suffer from spiritual attention deficit disorder. Some good thing happened and you can't focus on the cross no more. You focus on yourself. One little blessing happened. You can't focus on God anymore. You got to focus on your friends or your organizations. So every now and then, God tries to get our attention because at the core, sometimes we suffer from spiritual attention deficit disorder. Parables have for many years been preached from the perspective of human character.
Yes.
We've heard this parable many times from the perspective of the prodigal son. But actually, the parable was not taught to us to be an example of human character. But today, Jesus is showing us the true intention and nature of the love of God.
Yes.
And the essence of his kingdom. The parables are not about the characters. But the parables are about the very kingdom of God. And so this parable lets us know that although we may miss the mark in life, and although the enemy seeks to kill, steal, and destroy each and every one of us, I dare not let him stop us today.
No.
I dare continue to shout and sing his praises. Because the parable lets me know that in the midst of the storm,
yes,
there is restoration in God's love.
Yes, 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 yes.
God will restore.
Yes.
God will restore you.
Yes.
How does God restore us? God restores us in his love.
Yes.
Because we have to understand that God has a plan for us.
Yes.
What the prodigal son missed in the midst of his situation was that God had a plan to give him everything that he desired.
Yes.
And so I want you to understand today, God wants to restore you.
Yes.
Because God has a plan for you.
Yes.
God has a situation tailored just for you.
Yes.
And if you would hold your peace and let the Lord fight your battles,
yes,
certainly the victory shall be yours.
Yes.
If you understand the plan that God has, can no boyfriend beat that plan? Can no girlfriend beat that plan? The plan that God has, no level of education can make this plan plain. No level of wealth can make this plan realized. But what God has for me is for me. Look at your neighbor and say, what God has for me is for me. He loves us and he restores us. But I find the nature of God in the text, because the other thing that gives me joy is to understand that God loves me in the middle of my mess. God loves me in the middle of my faults. God loves me in the middle of me turning my back on him. Look at the text. The text never says that the Father gave up on the Son. The text never said that the Father said the Son was no good. I'm glad today that God's never given up on me. I'm glad today. father's house. He began to walk to his father's house. And look at how God will restore you. He'll restore you from afar off. He'll restore you wherever you are. As long as you come to yourself. The text says that he's walking to his daddy's house. And he's there afar off. But there's something about God's love. God can see you. Because of the natural order, or do I need to get with God? You come to me for marriage counseling, if you come to me with marriage counseling, that's good. Come on, come into the church first. Come in, take ownership. That's why we love the people of God that come and say, I need to get close with God. God wants to restore us. Put that old sensitive, short-sighted view of God down. He doesn't want to punish you. He loves you. You got to love Him. You got to stay close to Him. God's love, whatever you're going through right now, God can restore that thing. But you just gotta come to yourself. You gotta stop trying to decide who God is. He don't care what your location is. That's what some of us do. Well, I will come to God, but I'm just too bad. Who are you to determine what God can do? See, that's another level of me, myself, and I. Right, when you got so self-righteous that you vote yourself out of the presence of God. That's what Satan wants to operate to. You're good enough. Because when that boy came home, his father ran up to him, hugged him, kissed him. Go home and read it. They had a banquet in his honor. He sat and was stored at the table. You need to be back at the table where God has called you to be. He loves you. Faithful is our God. We're reaping the harvest God promised us. Taking back what the devil has stolen for us. We rejoice today. We shall recover. You know, give God some praise. Come on, lift him in this place. Come on, lift him in this place. Are you ready for him to restore you? Has he restored anybody in here? Come on and tell him thank you for what he's done. we thank you for abiding with us. Lord, we thank you today for a greater understanding of spiritual warfare. Lord, I ask that these your children become well aware that as long as they are on God's side, the enemy is on their track. He will seek to make them feel good outside of your presence. He will give them a spirit of me, myself, and I. He will operate in their impatience. And if he gets to those steps, he'll bring about their famine. But God, we ask for the spiritual fortitude now to see the devil coming when he's coming.
Yes.
And that we have the spirit of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Yes. Yes.
That when he was tempted with the riches of the world, he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by the word of God.
Yes.
So we thank you, God. We magnify you, God. We thank you for showing us your love in our restoration.
Yes.
We thank you for all the times we've fallen and you pulled us up.
Yes.
All the times we wanted to give up.
Yes.
And you put encouragement in our hearts.
Yes.
We thank you for the love
you of
your restoration.
Thank you.
Let every heart say, amen.
Amen.
I wish on that day, that the prodigal son had the access to the words of this song. What God has for me, it is for me.
Close the church up and say what?
What God has for me, it is for me.
Yeah.
means the enemy. The enemy is real. Our 8 years we've been here, the enemy is real. Because God's got his hand on us, he don't move in here the way he moves in other places. It's not over, it's covert. Little slick things I see. And we see them. I ask that we just see them together. Know the things that are going on in our lives that set God back and put the enemy forward. Let's continue to press our way. God has already, don't wallow in the sorrows of today's sermon. You say, I'm selfish. I made some bad decisions. I know that I'm broke. Don't worry about it. I want you to know you restored right now. You restored right now. See, the joy of coming into the house of God is not to know how bad it is, but to know you can get out of that thing. You out of that thing today, so just stop talking about it. Stop talking about how bad it is. Just having your spirit, it ain't that bad no more. God sees you from afar off. And he's sitting you at his table. Now the only thing you got to do is open up your invitation. Open up your Instagram. Open up your email. Snapchat with them if you want. Whatever it is that you want to do, just open it up. Stop keeping it closed. He'll hear you. He hears your fainting cry. And he answers by and by. Let the church say amen. At the on, keep blessing him in his place. We worship him because of who he is. Because he loves us and he cares for us. We worship him.